Good morning all. We are going to study about supercontinents today. The supercontinents are the part of the geological process since the Earth formed. There are several supercontinents emerged by joining as well as breaking up into pieces since the Earth formed. There are few probably I could name, starting from Valbara, Ur, Rodinia, and the latest supercontinent was Pangaea about 408 million years ago. We are going to talk about the Pangaea. Pangaea was formed around 480 million years ago. So there are the several evidences pertaining to Pangaea, where we don't have much evidences for any other supercontinents. Supercontinent. Supercontinent is the assembly of most or all of Earth's continental blocks or cratons to form a single large landmass. This is not the only one supercontinent. Pangaea is known to us. There are several supercontinents since 4.5 billion years to present were formed, and as I said, it's broken up. Probably I would call it with some few names. There are several been listed in the literature, but there are few probably I could spell it out for you. Valbara, Ur, Kenorland, Arctica, Atlantica, Columbia, Rodinia, Penusia, Gondwana, Laurasia and Gondwana joined together. Then the joining of Laurasia and Gondwana settled down around 480 million years ago. It's called Pangaea. We are going to talk about how Pangaea were formed, then later how broke up, give rise to seven different continents of. When you look at this is one of the supercontinent before Pangaea, around 1.1 giga annum, probably I'll call it as a billion years ago, 1.1 billion years ago. It was like this, like Baltica, Eurasia and Gondwana were distant apart, but the existence of the crotons are the broken pieces in the period of 1.1 billion years ago were rejoined to form Pangaea around 480 million years ago. How they have formed? It's a very gradual and slow process. The one continental mass is called Laurentia. It's nothing but North America merged with several other microcontinents of northern hemisphere. Later, they've joined with other American continental part to become a Euro-America. The settled down or the structure of Pangaea had formed around 408 million years ago. Then later what happened? Slowly they started breaking up. So that's how the supercontinental, the Pangaea, began to break up around 200 million years ago during Triassic. All these are actually the process of supercontinental cycle. In geography, when you're talking about the tectonic plates or volcanic movements and continental drift or Vicarious process, basically it's based upon the continental drift in a geological time. The supercontinental cycle, it's nothing but like formation of a supercontinent. Again, it will break into pieces, then it will deformed. Again, the another reorganization of all the broken pieces being formed as a single landmass. This is in cycle, that's why it's called a supercontinent cycle. They will rejoin, then they will break up. again they'll rejoin to have you under the name. So the latest supercontinent, probably the newest supercontinent, is the Pangaea. From Valbera to Pangaea, that is the process of the cycle had been accelerated since the Earth formed. So we are going to so look at the, because the evidence. So when you look at the Gondwana, I said it is furthermore split into five different continental mass. The one is Africa, South America, Antarctica, India, and Australia. Out of five, four are actually the different continents today, except India. India is a India is a subcontinent joined the Eurasia, Eurasia part of Asian continent. Laurasia is one is Eurasia, another one is. So what are all the evidences which provides us which provides us to know to talk about the tectonic these tectonic plate movements as well as the formation of seven present day continents after the breakup of Pangaean landmass. The first one is the coal deposits. We have actually been frequently discussed about this in our previous classes. The coal deposits, there's one evident which has been found in Pennsylvania, North America, exactly the geological time which was dated from Pennsylvania matches with the coal deposit present in Poland, Great Britain, and Germany of Europe, which tells that once upon a time, these land masses were together. It's evident based upon the carbon dating. The next one is the fossil record. When the recent explorations and paleobotanical explorations and expeditions unravel that the presence of glossopteris from different continents, now today they are actually very disparate continents, but it which indicates that the presence of the glossopteris, the fern species from these continent masses, indicates that these land masses were actually together once upon a time in geological time. So the extinction of the glossopteris during the process of the continental drift, it's evidenced here. And the next one is the presence of the Appalachians mountainous range. Today, where will you find this particular mountainous type in the world? The Appalachians have been found in the United States as well as in Morocco, which is Atlas Mountains. How would it be possible? Because Atlas Mountains in Morocco is present in African continent. The Appalachians of the United States is in North America. So the same, the topography of this mountainous range and the biotic presence, like the diversity of these Appalachians mountains, indicate that these Appalachians mountains were. This particular picture indicate the Great Appalachian Valley being found in Canada, America, the eastern part of Canada and America, where today, if you really wanted to see this valley, Hudson Valley, Chaplin Valley, all this valley are being started from the Canadian in southeast part to United States. It extends to United States southeast part. The same way, these are all the coniferous forest vegetation, where actually this could be been traced. These particular Appalachian mountains indicate geologically that they were together in geological time, dated back to 480 million years ago at the Pangaea, the settlement of all the broken pieces to regain the name Pangaea. During that period, they were together, where actually this can be traced. When you look at this picture, the North America, the eastern part of North America, as well as the western part of Africa, where there is the Morocco, Tunisia, all these countries, the present Morocco and Tunisia, shares the widest range of Atlas Mountains. So the Atlas Mountain here, as well as the Appalachian mountainous range of Canada and America, that indicates that they were together and then broken into two pieces. Then they have moved as North America moved towards west, and Africa has been centered, as you see that there are the undulations of the mountainous undulations, the different topography that also indicates that this has been formed in geological time. When you look at the Atlas has got three different classes of the mountainous ranges, starting from Anti-Atlas Range, High Atlas Range, and Mid-Atlas Range in Morocco. We know very well that, the presence of the Atlas Mountains is resulted to the Sahara Desert. And also not only the Sahara Desert, because of the Sahara Desert, the global winds have been regulated because it's a low pressure zone. The Sahara is in a low pressure zone where it is a stimuli, or probably I would say it's a focal point to draw the global winds from north and south pole. This is actually the reason for the particular global wind. When we talk about the coal deposits and the fossils which has been expedited from these deposits, indicate that what actually the life forms were existed during that period. The fossils what we have expedited from different continents, that indicates the same age, because the information of those vegetation been stored in the form of fossil. The fossilization is the type of fossilization is a carbonification. Carbonification is like it's a major process of the coal deposits. The vegetation during that period, Carboniferous period, there are the huge arborescent vegetations and the animal been living together during that period. And if they die, the dead material of the plant vegetation and the dead material of the animal will be remain in the swampy vegetation, which swampy means is a marshy and swampy vegetation. It will be then later it will become a peat. The peat it's become a coal. This is a process. It's not it happen it won't happen in a day, in few years. This happens in a vast geological period. So the vegetation as well as the dead animal parts, body parts, have been stored and carbonified during the process of the coal deposits. With respect to North American coal deposits, probably dated into two different names. One is early Carboniferous, the another one is late Carboniferous. It's a geological period. The early Carboniferous is called Mississippian. The late Carboniferous period is called from the Triassic, what actually the tectonic plate movements were occurred. We know that the Pangaea split into two large. So when we talk about some geographically very important region between the North America and Africa, then what would have occurred in the remaining sutures? So chess means where actually the plate got drifted. So we are going to look at that. The highlighted mark indicates the sutures of two different landmass, which is Laurasia and the Gondwana. Till today, you could see the geographical evidences that these are the regions have actually been connected, the Laurasia and Gondwana. Probably I would say it's a pasting material between these two huge supercontinents, which is Laurasia and Gondwana. The Hercynian and Variscan orogeny and Alleghenian orogeny. Alleghenian orogeny, we discussed in the earlier slide, which is the part of the Appalachians. Okay, Hercynian and Variscan, the name actually has been derived from Germany. One place called Verisica, it's a place and a valley in western, eastern Germany, and also it shares the border with the Western Russian Federation. So that the particular valley has got the very huge coal deposits. The particular coal deposits, gives us the geological time, probably when these areas have been there connected together. Can you see here the Paleotethys Ocean? Because the Paleotethys Ocean is nothing but the today's Arabian Sea, and the Arabian Sea is nothing but belongs to Indian Ocean. It's an Indian Ocean, probably where you are probably been looking at the India, where the India is present, probably just below, because India is furthermore down to the Gondwanic land. But we are here, what we are looking at here is that just the sutures of the Laurasia and Gondwana. What is orogeny? Probably this terminology probably would have been new to you. Orogeny is just a formation of mountains. Orogenesis is just a formation of the mountain. Okay, where probably you can look at the Variscian orogenesis, because that's very important, where actually the Laurasian part, it's especially the Laurasian part being split into two, correct? This is the one area where you will find the Variscica. But today you probably will Google it, you will get the place Variscica, where the Variscica is present. We know probably, so if I ask someone, probably you could answer what actually the mountainous range has been present in this area. We know very well that we have actually been discussed in our previous classes. It is Ural Mountains of Russia, or you could say it's a Ural River, which is present in the particular valley, that the Ural Mountain Valley, which splits, or probably it gives us the boundary between Asia and Europe. Asia and Europe. That's the one mountainous range which is present between that. That the layer, probably all these are highlighted ranges we are going to discuss about in our forthcoming classes. But in this class, probably I'm going to highlight the Ural Mountains. We know very well that it's a Tibetan plateau. When you come to this in Middle East, and all this in Himalayan range, just upper Himalaya, and these are all the Alps, Atlas. We know this also. We have been discussed Appalachian Mountain of North America. Ural Mountain. It's a very, very geographically very important area. It actually started from Arctic Ocean, the river, especially the river, the Ural River, comes from Arctic to the Caspian Sea. The Ural Mountain is a range. Also, it is perpendicular. It's very much perpendicular to the east and west direction. It's perpendicular. It's come from north to south, from Arctic Ocean to the Caspian Sea. Ural Mountain, what is the significance of it? it is, as I said, it also provides the boundary between Europe and Asia. And also, there is what we would like to see here is the mountain Narodnaya. It's the highest mountainous peak which is present in Ural Mountain, about 6,214 feet. A river which is flowing, the river and the Ural Mountainous range are both together. It makes, you know, it is territorial marking between Europe and Asia. And we were actually discussing about the boundary between Russia and Germany, because the Western Europe, actually the Eastern Europe is actually the Germany. The Western Asia in the upper continental range is that Russian Federation. So you would also say that where actually exactly the Ural Mountains are present, it's between Germany and Russia, and it comes down till the Caspian Sea. Probably we would I would probably complete with this sea floor spreading. So we were actually discussing about only the landmass and how the tectonical plate drifted, and how the continental plates have been moved from center. We know the center of Earth is Africa. From Africa, how the Pangaeic broken plates have moved to north as well as to south to form the seven different continents. As the same way, not only the landmass, along with the landmass, there is the oceanic surface which has been intact, which were intact along with this plate also been carried out. Basically, the sea floor spreading, it is not only the gallons of water, it's been splitted and spread over. That's why the sea spreading also plays a major, you know, geographical structure. Sea floor spreading is a process that occurs at mid-ocean ridges, the new oceanic crust. The oceanic crust along with the oceanic surface, but whichever the land which has been floating on top of that crust been carried away. That's how, when you probably imagine how the Indian plate would have traveled from Africa to Eurasia. It's formed through the volcanic activity, not truly only the volcanic activity, and also the tectonic plate movements and continental drift. So, the main underlying fact for the seafloor spreading is magnetism of the rocks. What is paleomagnetism? Is the study of the evidences which is been present in the form of, you know, archival material with respect to rock or sediment or any archaeological material, which gives us the information about the ancient geographical or geological process in geological time. That is called the paleomagnetism. How probably the Pangaea have been formed, how probably the Pangaea were broken up. Those informations what we actually get from the today's archival material or archaeological material. So the basically the rock and its magnetic field, the gravitational force and Coriolis effect, all these are played a major role in continental drift as well as the splitting of the oceanic crust into different plates. I'm just going to probably highlight the oceanic plate to have, you know, without map, understanding the geography is very, 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 very difficult. So we actually probably come across a few of the areas when we are discussing about the UPSC preliminary questions. India, probably that's a highlight here, because we would like to always focusing on Indian plate, right? So probably now we have got the names to say seven continents. Pertain to that seven continents, probably how the seven continents been taken their own name to have the separate plate. What I'm mentioning here is we would like to see the plates in seven different continents, correct? Probably I would go the same series. The North American plate, it is not only with North American landmass. North American plate, which includes, probably you should, if I ask any question, probably you should know the oceanic crust of the North American plate, it's which include the North America, Greenland, and Alaska, and erosion of the, probably what would you get here, Japan, Alaska, and some of the Siberian part, which belongs to one oceanic crust, which is North American plate. Same way, the Pacific plate, the entire Pacific Ocean, which belongs to the Pacific plate, the Australian, which is not actually the Indian plate, is there is no Indian plate such, it's like that. It is Indo-Australian plate, but recently the geographical hypotheses are proposed in the theory to say that Indian plate itself is a separate plate. But earlier it is called as a Indo-Australian plate, which belongs to one plate. Probably you could see the Australian plate and the Indian plate belongs to one plate. The Eurasian plate is the large place from which starts from the which includes the Europe continent as well as the major part of the Asian continent and the South American plate. But interestingly, the Antarctica, we know very well that the down part is an Antarctic plate. But interestingly, there are small plates, but it will have the very important in geological process. Probably I would like to highlight a few of the plates. One is the Arabian plate, the Arabian plate, as well as the Caribbean plate, where actually still there is some geological process, it's been accelerating. The splitting or the movements of the function. The Arabian Peninsula with that Arabian landmass, as well as the Isthmus of Panama and the that connection, no? Isthmus of Panama is a Caribbean plate, which belongs to the Caribbean plate. The Caucasus plate of includes which includes the Galapagos and Ecuador oceanic range. All these are very important plates because which are smaller, but I would say are the reason for any further plate movements. I would like to Jurassic to the recent, which is Quaternary period, where we are actually now, the present to the present. When you date from Jurassic to present, probably you like to see here how the oceanic plate looks. So we would like to see the ridges, where all the ridges have been formed. In fact, there is a ridge within the Indo-Australian plate, there is a ridge between India and Australia. So major part of the Indian Ocean actually it belongs to Australian plate, and the other peninsular part are base of Indian Oceans, which is Arabian Peninsula as well as the Bay of Bengal, it belongs to India. So this is how the sea floor spreading it belongs to that different plates been arranged. Okay,